Let's go to Exodus chapter 20 this morning. Exodus chapter 20 should be a very familiar passage of scripture to us. We're just going to look at the first three verses, and then we have some other scriptures to get into as we make our way into the message this morning. And God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me." For the next 10 weeks, I want to take a trip together to Mount Sinai. I want us to travel back in time about 3,500 years. We believe that this was written about 1450 BC. Go to the mountain where God gave the Ten Commandments to Moses and to the 2.5 million Jews, we believe, roughly about that number, that were led out of Egypt. God audibly revealed these commandments to Israel. Now, we've all watched Cecil B. DeMille's movie enough times, I think, to get the idea that God revealed these words just to Moses, and then Moses kind of regurgitated them to the people. That's not correct. If you look back with me at chapter 19, if you still have your Bible open, I trust that you will do that because we're going to reference the text in a couple of ways here this morning. Verse 9 says, "The Lord said to Moses, I am going to come to you in a dense cloud so that the people will hear me speaking with you and will always put their trust in you." Now, in Deuteronomy chapter 5, which most of you will remember, is the second place in the scriptures where the Ten Commandments are given to us. They're repeated there. Verse 22, the first verse after the commandments are quoted, says, "These are the commandments the Lord proclaimed in a loud voice to your whole assembly there on the mountain from out of fire and cloud and deep darkness, and he added nothing more." In other words, there weren't 11 commandments, there were 10. But God spoke these words out loud to the people, making this, think about it, the only portion of scripture that God revealed in this way. I mean, short of the red-letter words of Jesus in the Gospels. Then, to make sure that the people wouldn't forget them, God chiseled them with his finger onto two stone tablets, which were eventually put into the Ark of the Covenant, placed in the tabernacle, later in the temple, so that the people would never forget. So these words are unique among all the words that God revealed to his people and to all of humanity. And they should hold a special place in our lives, just as they did for the Israelites. Now, I know that many of us are very familiar with these commandments. In fact, we may have heard these words before we were even saved. Because I can remember the day when this was read every Sunday in church. Anybody been there, done that? Yeah. These words hang in many of the courthouses of our nation for a while yet. Although their presence in the public square, if you've been following all of this, has been challenged in recent years by those who want to push for an absolute separation of church and state. What those activists are really pushing for is not the freedom of a religion in America, they're pushing for the freedom from religion. They want no religion in the United States of America, and especially no Christian religion. As we move forward in the book of Exodus, these commands are elaborated upon, and I would encourage you to just go forward in the reading, Exodus 21 and following, in the weeks ahead. But then when we get to the book of Leviticus, you see that God gave the people the sacrificial system. Now, that whole system of sacrifice, the gory killing of animals, the spilling of blood on the altar, was established because of man's sin and to provide atonement for man's guilt in sinning, in not keeping the Ten Commandments. I find it rather ironic that this law of God was given to the Israelites right after they had come through what is called the desert of sin. Did you ever realize that or catch that? You look at a Bible map and you will see that after they crossed over from Egypt, across the Red Sea, into the Sinai Peninsula, the Israelites wandered literally through the wilderness of sin, from the Hebrew word from which we get Sinai, Sinai, literally in the Hebrew. It's kind of ironic, isn't it? It's a play on words, of course, in the English, but I find that kind of interesting. It's also interesting to note when the law was given. The law was given to Israel after they had been saved by the blood of the Passover lamb. Remember, sprinkled on the lentils and the doorposts in Egypt? It wasn't given to them before they went to Egypt or while they were in Egypt. It was after they were saved. And that should help us as we go through this law in the next couple of months. It's going to take at least 10 weeks, right? To remember that we do not obtain our righteousness by keeping the law, because no one can keep the law perfectly. Paul says in Galatians 3:11, clearly, no one is justified before God by the law. If the Jews could have kept the law perfectly, they would not have ever needed the sacrificial system to atone for sin. And if you and I could keep the Ten Commandments of God and all the commands of God perfectly, we would not have needed a Savior. Jesus coming to give his life as a sacrifice for us would not have been necessary, because our justification, our holiness, would have been accomplished by us having perfect obedience. But as Romans 3 says so pointedly, quoting from the Psalms, there is no one who is righteous, not even one. There's no one who understands, no one who seeks God. All of us have turned away. There is no one who does good, not one. All of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And friends, the glory of God is his holiness. That's why we sang that song just now. The angels, the seraphim, the cherubim, continually sing, "Holy, holy, holy." God's glory is his holiness. And he says, "You be holy, even as I am holy." Now, if we look back at chapter 19 again, just a moment, in verses 5 and 6, the Lord says there to the Israelites, "Now if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, my commandments, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation." And Peter, of course, quotes that in 1 Peter 2:9. But folks, that was not only a vision of God's purpose and design for Israel, that was God's vision and purpose for the United States of America, that we would be one nation under God, a holy nation. But we can't be holy, either as a nation or as individuals, because sin entered into the world through Adam and Eve, and all of us, without exception, we're affected by that. It is impossible for us to live perfectly for God. We are in a miserable, lost condition. And most people, even those who go to church, don't realize how bad it is. So the law was given, Paul tells us in Galatians 3:24, to be a schoolmaster, to bring us to Christ, so that we might be justified by faith in him. Friends, we can only get holiness from Christ, and obviously from the operation of the Holy Spirit. He's called the Holy Spirit for a reason. He sanctifies us, purifies us. Paul says in Romans 3:20 that through the law, get this, through the law we become conscious of sin. That is to say, without the law to tell us, we would have never known how much we failed God. and his expectations. It's kind of like a thermometer. You use a thermometer to understand that there's something wrong. It doesn't necessarily diagnose the illness. It certainly doesn't treat the illness, but it tells you, hello, something is wrong. You're spiking a fever. Or a speed limit sign on the highway. It says 55 miles an hour. Now, that's not gonna force you to drive 55, but it's gonna tell you that's the law. And there's an authority behind the law that should control your behavior. And it tells you, if you go more than 55, you're a lawbreaker. Guilty as charged. Or it's like a mirror. You look at the mirror and you see a smudge of dirt on your face. Now, you don't use the mirror to remove the smudge, but the mirror tells you there's something wrong here. That's the law. In Romans 7:7, Paul says, I would not have known what sin was except through the law. So it was given to us to help us to realize by our very nature that we're lawbreakers and that we needed a Savior. As Chris sang about, we needed God to come and to rescue us, to die in our place. The blood of atonement, the sacrifice of atonement needed to be shed over us. Now, we're going to go through these commandments, and we're going to see that they're not just about physical things. They're really spiritual. They deal with external behavior, obviously, but more than that, they deal with our hearts. They deal with our hearts, with the internal thoughts, the motivations, the ambitions of our lives. So really, no one is able then to keep the law, even if it looks on the outside like they were. Now, we know that in Christ, the New Testament teaches clearly that we are set free from the law of sin and death. We are set free from the condemnation of the law, but listen, we are not set free from the moral obligation of the law. Now, other kinds of law that God gave to Israel, ceremonial law, you know, social law, some of that we set aside, but not this law. And as we look at these, we'll find that all of the Ten Commandments are fully endorsed and fully enforced by Christ and by the writers of the New Testament. We have liberty in Christ, but we are still not allowed to murder and commit adultery and steal from others, are we? There's only one of the ten here that's considered kind of more of a ceremonial law. It's the fourth commandment about keeping the Sabbath. That one of the ten has been kind of set aside within the Jewish community, within the Christian community, but it really was meant to be a law for all people. And we'll talk about that when we come to it. But all of these laws, friends, are binding upon us today. So, for example, we can't go out and take the name of God in vain, or covet someone's spouse or their property and say, well, it's okay for me to do that because I'm no longer under the law, I'm under grace, and it doesn't really matter if I do that or not. Who are you kidding? Of course it matters. We can't do that. These commandments are binding upon all of us for all time. Well, if I don't get started on commandment number one, we're not going to get through it. So all of that by way of introduction. Let's look at these verses that we read. Verses 1 and 2 are really kind of like a preamble to the Ten Commandments. God is simply identifying himself to the Israelites as their God, as the God who powerfully brought them out of their slavery and bondage in Egypt. And then verse 3 gives us number 1. You shall have no other gods before, or some of our versions will say, besides me. And that's a prohibition against polytheism. And what's really behind this commandment is the fact that all of the other nations of the world were polytheistic in their religion. Abraham and Sarah saw it when they lived in the Chaldees, in the area of Babylon. They had their deities. Jacob and Isaac saw it in Canaan when they lived among the Canaanites with the Baal worship and the Molech worship. Joseph and the Jews saw it when they lived for 400 years among the Egyptians. I don't even know how many gods they had. All of the religions of the ancient Near East had multiple gods. All of Israel's neighbors knew, or thought they knew, that the universe was a jungle of warring supernatural powers. Some good, some evil, but all demanding to be pleased and placated in one way or another. Israel, on the other hand, was called to a strict belief in only one God. One God. And that is why the greatest teaching, the greatest prayer of the Jewish people, even Orthodox Jews to this day, called the Shema, declares, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." He's one. That means he is God alone. That brings me to the first point of application that we can draw from the commandment this morning, that our worship must be directed to God alone. That is to say, there must be no worshiping of, no praying to someone or something else. And apparently this was a pretty big problem for the Israelites. If you turn with me to Leviticus this morning, to Leviticus chapter 17, verse 7. Let's just jump over the next book. Leviticus 17, 7. God is speaking here, of course. It says, "They," meaning Israel, "must no longer offer any of their sacrifices to the goat," G-O-A-T, "idols, to whom they prostitute themselves. This is to be a lasting ordinance for them and for the generations to come." The word for goat idols there is literally in the Hebrew, "hairy ones." The hairy ones. So I think it includes any kind of animal, not just goats. And we know, remember, once that while Moses was up on Mount Sinai, Aaron, his brother, and a few other misguided people among the people of Israel fashioned a golden calf, and they prostituted themselves around that golden calf. Let's turn to Deuteronomy 32 a moment, flip over a couple more books, the last book of the Pentateuch, Deuteronomy 32, verse 16. Says they, again Israel, made him, that refers to God, jealous with their foreign gods and angered him with their detestable idols. They sacrificed to demons, which are not God. Gods they had not known, gods that recently appeared, gods your fathers did not fear. So obviously, keeping this first commandment was a little bit of a problem for the Israelites. And you know what? It's a problem for a lot of people today, too. Now, for those of us who have grown up in the Christian faith within the church, maybe lived all of our lives in the highly educated, developed, technologically advanced civilization of the Western world, we might not think that there's a lot of gods out there. But if you speak to someone who is a missionary, and I'm sure you probably have, or you have spent any amount of time in third world nations, you understand that many cultures recognize a pantheon of deities in their worldview. I mean, it's just common for them to have hundreds, if not thousands, of gods. The Bible reveals that other gods are those, I should say, who claim to be God, like Baal, Molech, Marduk, Zeus, do exist, in people's minds at least, but they're not gods at all. They're constructs, friends, of the evil one, of the great deceiver, of Satan. Only the true and living God, the creator of the universe, the creator of our lives, is worthy of worship. Let's move on to number two. The second point of application this morning. We must be totally consecrated, committed to God. Only God can govern and guide our lives. Now, we'll get into this a little bit more deeply when we talk about the second commandment, you know, not having graven images and all of that. But this involves not seeking guidance or help from gods, quote unquote, small g, or spirits, or from the dead, We have to trust the Lord for everything in our lives, and not just trust him for the forgiveness of our sins and the answering of our prayers and just the spiritual things. We have to trust the Lord to guide us by his word, lead us by his Holy Spirit when it comes to our educational choices, our decisions about dating and marriage, our financial matters, our vocational concerns, everything in our lives. And that means that we should not be messing around or allowing our children or our grandchildren to mess around with things like Ouija boards, tarot cards, should not be consulting palm readers and psychics, or reading horoscopes. Those things cannot and they do not guide the direction of any human being on the face of the planet any more than the man on the moon. And last time I checked, there aren't any men on the moon. That was like 40 years ago, and he came home. Friends, listen, there is a huge danger here. Because if you believe that such things have supernatural power in your life, you open yourself to the demonic spirits that are behind them. And Satan will rush through that open door and establish spiritual strongholds in your life, and he will weave his lies and deceptions and take control. No kidding. That's what's happening to a lot of the young people in our day that mess around with this stuff and think it's fun. You dabble with danger. Look to the Lord and his word to lead you and guide you. The third and final point of application from commandment number one. We are to seek and love God with our whole heart and soul and mind and strength and rely on him to provide what is good for us. Now that means, among other things, that you don't look to the church or your small group or your pastor to be the first and the primary source of your knowledge and understanding about God. Now, that might sound a little bit strange to some of you, but you're to turn to God. Have your own personal relationship to God. You turn to God's word. You become a student of the scriptures. You ask God himself to give you wisdom and understanding and discernment, right? Now, that doesn't mean you can't look to the church or your pastor or your small group for some help, but it's not your first and primary source of understanding. It also means that you don't look to your employment and your paycheck to be the thing that provides for your daily bread and the money that you need to pay your bills. I mean, let's not be confused. You have a job, or maybe you don't have a job, but you get money because God himself provides it. I mean, that's the true source of those blessings, right? It's not the Social Security system. It's not that pension you set aside years ago. It's God. This may also mean that when you're going on a trip or you're doing something where you sense that your life could be at risk, you don't hang a medallion of some patron saint of protection and safety from the rearview mirror of your car or around your neck or stick it in your pocket, thinking that that patron saint is going to keep you safe on your journey. And you don't bury a little statue of St. Joseph in your yard if you're trying to sell your house, thinking that that's going to help you do that. This is what this means. And I say that respectfully, not demeaningly, of those who may be coming out of a Roman Catholic background, because I have found plenty of other believers, Protestant and otherwise, who look at these things and they think, well, yeah, hey, a little extra help, let's go for it. Dabbling with danger. Brothers and sisters, patron saints do not provide for the needs in your life. God does. In fact, Scripture says, where does my help come from? And the confession of David and all the saints through the ages has been, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I said last week, quoting James 1:17, every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father in heaven. Every gift, including the breath that you just breathed right now. Now, the ultimate question behind this commandment, as well as every single one of the other commandments, is why should you keep this? Why should you follow this? Now, if you were one of the Israelites standing on Mount Sinai, my answer to you would be, because he is Yahweh, your God, who brought you out of bondage and saved you from the slavery and death of Egypt. But you will say, well, I'm not an Israelite. I've never even been to Egypt. I'm a Gentile, and I've never been a slave of anyone or anything, really. But why should you keep this commandment and all the rest? Well, the answer is because he is Yahweh, your God, who gave you life and brought you out of the bondage of sin and saved you from death by sending his son, Jesus Christ, to deliver you. Christ came and died for all men. And my friend, that includes you. Even if you do not yet believe in Christ or trust in Christ, the Bible says Christ died for you. Even if you're an atheist, even if you hate God and you don't believe a word of his Bible, the scripture says that God loves you and that God sent his only son to die for you, to set you free. And because God did that, he is worthy of your obedience and your worship. Now, many of us, those of us who grew up in the Reformed tradition, know that the Ten Commandments are included in the Heidelberg Catechism. You did remember that, right? It's in there with the section on gratitude, how we respond to God for delivering us of our misery and our guilt, so along with the Apostles' Creed and the Lord's Prayer. I want to close today by looking at the question and answer that pertains to this first commandment. It's number 94. And it asks the question, what does the Lord require of us in the first commandment? And the answer comes, and we'll put this up on the screen, because I would like all of us to read this answer aloud this morning, kind of as a closing confession of our faith and our trust in the Lord. So let's go ahead and read this together. That I, not wanting to endanger my very salvation, avoid and shun all idolatry, magic, superstitious rites, and prayer to saints or to other creatures, that I sincerely acknowledge the only true God, trust him alone, look to him for every good thing, humbly and patiently, love him, fear him, and honor him with all my heart. In short, that I give up anything rather than go against his will in any way. That's a good answer. And may God grant that that be the desire and the intention of all of our lives today and always. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you this morning that you are a revealing God, a God who desires to be in relationship with us, your creation, the people that you formed and fashioned in your own image for yourself, for your enjoyment, for your glory, for your holy purposes. And that, Lord, to build and solidify and guide that relationship, you gave us this law. And Lord, I pray that you would write this law upon our hearts, that, Lord, in the living of our days, that we would have no other gods before you, besides you. Because in reality, in truth, there are no other gods except you. You alone are God. You alone are worthy of our worship and our praise. You alone are worthy of all obedience. We owe you our lives, Lord, and we need you in our lives because we are lost in a condition of brokenness and misery and sinfulness and rebelliousness and disobedience. And we cannot keep your law, we cannot live for you as you would desire without the help of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, if there's any person here this morning who is not sure if they know you, if they possess your Holy Spirit within their soul, within their body, that Lord, you are eager and willing and you are ready and you are able to pour out your Holy Spirit in their lives, the moment that they cry out, Lord, I repent of my sin. I acknowledge that you made me for yourself, and I have been living for myself. And I repent of that today. I acknowledge that I am a sinner and that I cannot redeem myself through any efforts of my own. I will never be a good enough person to save myself or to earn my way into your heaven. And so I pray that you would save me by the shed blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, whom you sent to this world for that very purpose, and that you would give me your Holy Spirit and make me a new person today. Lead me to yourself, guide my life, take my life, cleanse me of all known and unknown sin, and Lord, help me to live obediently for you all the days of my life. Hear my prayer, for I ask it in the name of your glorious Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.